Hey, John Smith with Extra Hop Networks again. Today I want to talk a little bit about how to detect the use of Let's Encrypt within your namespace. I'm a big supporter of the EFF. I've donated money to them, but the truth is a lot of bad actors use CertBot to try to make their phishing sites and their illegitimate sites look legitimate by avoiding a certificate error. And the chief product that they're using in most cases, or in a lot of cases at least, is Let's Encrypt or CertBot. In fact, if you look here, this article is a little bit old, but as of 2017, they're saying Let's Encrypt has actually issued 15,270 PayPal-related certificates. I'm pretty sure that none of them have anything to do with PayPal. So what I'm going to talk about is how you want to look for, is my namespace being accessed by someone internally via, and is the certificate issuer is the certificate issuer a nefarious one, whether that's Let's Encrypt or another nefarious issuer. In this case, I'm calling out specifically, I'm looking for a match on Let's Encrypt. I'll walk through this, but if I were you in your environment, I would have an understanding of what are the certificate issuers that my namespace uses, and I might create an array here of not really of subject alternative names, but I might create an array of, this is the list of approved issuers in anything with my namespace that's not issued by one of these approved issuers. I want to flag that as a potential phishing, especially if it's sourcing from internally. I know there's not a lot that we can do externally about phishing sites that aren't visible to us, but at least when someone tries to spear phish your individual end users, you'll be able to see, hey, I know that this site looks a lot like ours, and some of these phishing sites are incredibly convincing. I know it looks like ours. I know that it has a lock on it and it has an approved SSL certificate, but it wasn't issued by one of our approved SSL certificate issuers. So let's just take a hypothetical. I have a new, and I kind of went and grabbed this domain, so it's not my domain, but let's say I have a new sexy startup called designmycakes.io, and I have the .io TLD because I want to be cool. But I want to be able to make sure that someone doesn't try to fish my people using designmycakes.com or something like that. So now, like I said earlier, I would create an array of issuers, and I would fire on anything that didn't match those. But here I'm going to just look specifically. If the issuer is Let's Encrypt, and somewhere in the subject alternative name is designmycakes, I don't care if it's .com, .net, .cn, .com, .cn, .uk, .cn, whatever. It doesn't, if it's using my namespace and it wasn't issued by one of my certificate authorities, then I want it flagged and I want an alert on it. So in this case, that's what we're going to do. We're going to flag it. We're going to add a little wrinkle to this. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to check it against VirusTotal. So I've configured the VirusTotal API. Please don't use my API or they'll kick me out. But I've used the VirusTotal API. I'm going to query the VirusTotal API. I'm going to use for the server IP address, right? So I'm going to get a match on Let's Encrypt. I'm going to get a match on my namespace, and I'm going to take that IP address and I'm going to ask VirusTotal, do you have a dossier on this IP address? You can use Recorded Future. You can use any API derived cyber threat intelligence, CrowdStrike. I've done a lot of work with Alien Vault in some of the videos. In this case, VirusTotal has some pretty good data on phishing sites. So we're going to go ahead and check that IP against there. So to do a quick example, I'm just going to go ahead and go to designmycakes.com. So let's say I have an end user that's gotten a phishing email. Designmycakes.com looks legit. They're able to basically steal my images and make a HTML formatted email that looks perfect. And maybe they know a lot about my customer because of different breaches that have happened, or they don't know a lot about my end user because of the different breaches that have happened. So they click the link and they go to the website. So here we've gone to the Design My Cakes website. So what's going to happen again is we're going to submit the server IP address to VirusTotal, and it's going to come back and it's going to tell us whether or not there's an API. Now we have to wait for the UI to refresh here, but understand that a lot of the RESTful activities that are going on, those happen within milliseconds. So this checking IP 162.241.224.161 took about 10 seconds to see here. Understand that that happened in less than a second on the back end. We just, in this case, we need to wait for the UI to refresh. So again, keep in mind the UI isn't actually the speed that we're working. What's happening under the hood is that we are doing these checks within milliseconds. So while we wait to hear back from the VirusTotal, there we've got a response from VirusTotal. So it does appear that the server IP that we were checking actually does contain a VirusTotal dossier, and in fact, 5 out of 70 examples for a 7% malicious payload match are actually malicious there, right? So this is, again, some of the things that you can do. So we've checked, we've found a nefarious issue, or at least in terms of how we do business. I'm sure there's legit business for Let's Encrypt, but we've found something that just doesn't make sense, right? My namespace should not be used with Let's Encrypt. Actually, if you look at the subject alternative name of this, it's got like 17 different subject alternative names. So obviously, it's leveraging what I call the internet's red light district in terms of CIDR blocks. It's using a lot of these transient IPs. So again, then if we also come over here, we'll see that we actually have a VirusTotal detection. Now, this is all within our UI console. In terms of what happens under the hood, if you wanted this to go to your SOAR like Demisto or Phantom, or you wanted this to go to your SIM like Splunk, Sumo Logic, QRadar, something like that, all of those things would happen in less than 1 second. In this case, we're sort of bound by the UI, which is not terribly uncommon. So again, this is John Smith with Extra Hop Networks, and this is an example of looking for nefarious or non-standard issuers of certificates. Thanks.